welcome to Old Stonewell Farm. Yes, we had another snowstorm the other night, but this morning when I woke up, everything was just so still. That beautiful stillness that comes after the snow falls. And everything was so pristine that I couldn't resist. I had to make a snow angel, or two, or even three. And as I got up and I looked at my heavenly creations, I realized my eyes need to be open more to the angels that are all around. My eyes need to be open more to what God is doing. For Ralph Waldo Emerson once wrote, "All I have seen teaches me to trust the Creator for all I have not seen." All I have seen, the beauty all around here at Old Stonewell Farm, it does teach me to trust God for all the things that I have not seen. All the angels that are surrounding me, all the God moments that I fail to recognize. All the moments of grace that are always there. Well, yes, I am making paper snowflakes today. It was just one of those mornings that I woke up and I've just been so stressed out lately that I just wanted to connect with my inner child. And I think we need to do that more. Just wake up one Saturday morning and allow yourself to watch cartoons while eating a bowl of cereal sitting on the couch. Well, I'm not the only one who did that. And you have to have your pajamas on still. So in your pajamas, bowl of cereal, Saturday morning cartoons, or buy a coloring book and crayons in color. Today, I decided to make paper snowflakes. I guess I was inspired by the snow that fell last night. I have to say, I like the snow, I do. But it was nice these past few days here in Vermont that the sun is getting brighter and the snow began to melt. And there was a few patches on the trail that I go running on that I was actually able to run and not waddle like a penguin because there was no more ice or snow on that part of the trail. It was actually gravel again. And it felt so good to run. But it didn't last. We got a storm yesterday and we have about 2 inches on the ground with 3 inches of ice or 2 inches of ice and another couple of inches of snow. So it's a total mess out there. I won't be able to run like I have been wanting to for probably another few weeks. I haven't paid attention to what the groundhog said. Is spring coming or do we still have some more winter? I just didn't pay attention. But I decided to make some paper snowflakes. I just wanted to feel like a child again, and you're never too old to do this. I remember one time in seminary when being really stressed out with papers that were due and exams that were coming up, that my friend Anne came to my dorm room, and I think it was in February. It must have been. We just wanted to hang out together. And I say it's February because we both weren't dating anyone at the time. So we were alone on Valentine's Day. Now that I remember that, we were joking that, you know, we were spending Valentine's Day together. So she came over to my dorm room. And again, we were both stressed out. Semester was in full swing. It was Valentine's Day and, you know, woe is us. And so we looked over at my printer with a little bit of paper left. Now, mind you, I needed that paper to print out a 20-page report that I had written about the environment and the kingdom of God. That was a good paper. I'll share that with you another time. But instead of using that paper in the printer to print out my paper that was due for class, we decided to make snowflakes. And we really failed miserably at it. We just couldn't remember, how did we do this as children? And they just weren't coming out with like the pointy edges. They were just still round. And we sat there laughing on the floor of my dorm room, wondering, we were able to do this as children. Why can't we do this now? I think it's because as we get older, we put too many expectations on ourselves to be perfect, to achieve everything. And I think as children, maybe our snowflakes weren't that great as we remembered. Maybe they were beautiful because we saw the beauty in them. So I wanted to make some snowflakes today just to take a deep breath and relax. I have been feeling under the weather, and I have to say I am feeling so much better. It is great to be here with you, feeling a little more, I'm not going to say 100%, but 99%. And I just wanted to have some beauty and some joy and be a child again. There's too much pressure in the world, too many demands. And that pressure and those demands, well, if you're anything like me, most of the time, you're just doing it to yourself. So I woke up today wanting just to be a child again. Perhaps just reconnect with a faith that is like a child. Accepting and trusting, seeing the beauty in all. So I sat here making paper snowflakes. And as I was doing it, I was reminded of a local Vermonter, in fact, Wilson Bentley. In 1885, Wilson Bentley from Vermont, a little small town, was given a microscope when he was just 15 years old. And what he decided to do with it, there was a snowstorm the following day, and he took a piece of black velvet and he took some snow and he looked at the snow underneath the microscope, and he was in awe at how each flake was different and so beautiful, the patterns. And so Wilson Bentley was the first person to ever photograph a snowflake. He would go on and photograph more than 5,000 flakes, all different, all unique. So I was thinking about that today as well, how this one man just was in awe at God's beauty, a childlike quality, just to embrace the simplest of all things. I mean, who would have thought? You have a microscope. Who would have thought of taking snow and putting it underneath the microscope? Sometimes the most beautiful things that God has for us are those things that we cannot see with our human eyes, that we have to really see with hearts of faith. Isaiah has a vision of the holiness of God. He gets to see God on the throne, and he's feeling very unworthy and insecure. He doesn't feel like he can be the one to take care of God's children, to speak for God to God's children. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am living among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out."
Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, Here I am, send me.
Us with scripture. And he sees this vision, and God is on the throne and surrounded by seraphs. Now, seraphs are angels, winged creatures, divine creatures, and they have many wings. In fact, one pair of wings cover their eyes because you cannot take in the entire glory of God. Another pair of wings covers the feet as a sign of respect and holiness. And then the other pair of wings, well, they are, I guess, used to fly around joyfully. So Isaiah is seeing this grand vision, and after he says, Woe is me, I'm not worthy really to serve you, God, or to speak, one of the seraphs, the angels, which is a fiery creature, takes a hot coal and burns Isaiah's, as touches Isaiah's lips to purify Isaiah. So now he's ready to proclaim. But this passage brings us one of, I think, the all-time favorite songs in congregations. It is an all-time favorite in every single church that I have served. It is an all-time favorite in other denominations that I have heard my friends mention. And it comes from Isaiah 6, Here I Am, Lord. That beautiful song, Here I Am, Lord. I have heard you crying in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. That's where we get this song from, Isaiah. Because Isaiah then says to God, Here I am. Send me. I will do what must be done to proclaim your goodness out in the world. The first time I heard that song, I wasn't familiar with it at all. It was when I was going back to church when I lived in Manhattan. And I would get there early because we all have our favorite pews. I want to make sure I got my pew. Yes, I do understand I have my pew. That's where I want to sit. I do understand it. So I got there early to church because I wanted to get my pew, but I also got there early because I loved hearing the choir practice. And so I would walk into the church and it was relatively empty, you know, people preparing for worship, the ushers and getting the bulletins out. And that one day I walked in early, I heard the choir singing that line from Here I Am, Lord. Here I am, Lord. It is I, Lord. I have heard you calling in the night. And I just stood there. I froze. And I took it all in, the beauty, the divine, this overwhelming feeling of grace, of opportunity, of my life is changing. Because I stood there and I felt all of that in 1 second or two. And I heard my heart whisper, I have heard you calling. I need to follow. Here I am. Did I feel worthy? Not at all. Did I feel equipped? Not at all. And yet God doesn't call those who know it all, who are equipped. Heck, God doesn't even call the worthy. God calls the broken, those who are struggling, those who are questioning. And so I said, here I am, let me follow. And that led me to leaving Manhattan. That led me to sitting in Princeton Theological Seminary dorm with my friend Anne, making snowflakes out of the paper that should have printed my 20-page report on the environment and the kingdom of God. Here I am, Lord. Have you heard God calling you? Are you questioning? Are you wondering? Are you on the right path? Are you following where God wants you to follow? I will admit I have been questioning that a lot lately. You know that I left traditional church and I'm still getting people saying, oh, I'm so sorry you're not a pastor anymore, but I am, I am. Just the other day, I had a friend, I was catching up with her via a phone call, and she's like, so what are you doing now? But she sounded so sad. What are you doing now? And it was just so, I don't know, it's just been very interesting. What am I doing now? I'm still serving God. I'm still serving God each and every day. Each and every day, we serve God in unique ways. Your way is different from my way. We're all different, yet beautiful, like a snowflake. We are all serving God. You know, Isaiah wasn't the first person in Scripture to say to God, "Here I am." There's a long line of people in Scripture who have answered God's call. Remember Samuel hearing God's voice? And Samuel answers, "Here I am." Moses, when God says, "Where are you, Moses?" "Here I am." "Here I am." Jacob, to God, "Here I am." But how eager are we to say that to God, "Here I am"? Because once we surrender, the fun begins. Once we surrender, once we say yes to God, life will change. My life hasn't gotten any easier. I thought it would as I got older, but it hasn't. In fact, right now, I'm in a season of great, not discernment, but I'm in a season of great questioning. I'm questioning if I'm really hearing God correctly. And I guess it's normal. I get a little hesitant when people say, "Oh, this is what God wants for me." Do we really know? We try our best, right? Discernment isn't easy. And I guess you know that you're on the right path when you feel this peace. And I do feel this peace, but lately I'm also feeling divine discomfort. I've written about this before. I had a pastor say that to me one time when I was feeling exactly what I'm feeling now. I found myself, rather than getting down to work that I had to get down to and deadlines that I have, finding myself coloring or making paper snowflakes. Basically, she said that it's just divine discomfort. When you feel that discomfort in your life, sometimes it's divine. It's God trying to get your attention. So I'm on this path, but yet there's still this little bit of discomfort, and I'm not quite sure what that's about. But I know that I got to just keep praying, keep questioning, keep asking God, keep trusting God, keep having that childlike faith. I guess that's why I wanted to make my snowflakes, to reconnect with that child inside of me and let go of all that knowledge and wisdom and academia and I'm an adult and I can figure this out. No, sometimes I just have to say, "God, I can't figure it out." No, Isaiah wasn't the first person to say, "Here I am, here I am." Many have said that. But as I read once again Isaiah's beautiful words, and I thought about that moment so many years ago when I first heard that song that almost every single denomination, every single congregation loves, "Here I am, Lord." I didn't think so much about my response to God. I didn't think so much about asking you to respond to God with your, "Here I am, Lord." What I thought about more today, it was a little bit later on in Isaiah. Yes, early in Isaiah, Isaiah 6, we get the prophet saying, "Here I am, send me." But then later on, in Isaiah 65, it is God crying out to the people, "Here I am, here I am." Have you ever thought that God too cries out to you? "Here I am, Donna, here I am." And so it's not so much about me right now saying yes to God, saying, "Here I am, send me." I mean, I want to be open. I want to surrender. I want to really just say, "Okay, God, I'm ready for that wild ride again." But right now, I realize that I have to stop thinking about my response to God, and I need to spend more time realizing that God has been shouting at me, whispering to me, waving God's hands at me, sending a mighty wind to rustle through the bare tree limbs to catch my attention. Like the other day when I was on the trail, the wind was really picking up and it was beautiful. There was little buds on the pussy willow branches just starting to peek through because it was so warm. But I have to realize that God, in every beautiful way, is shouting, whispering, waving God's arms via the tree limbs in the wind. And God is saying to me, here I am. Donna, here I am. So this day, connect with your inner child. Make a snowflake. A reminder that there's so much beauty in the world, and there's so much beauty in the differences, in the uniqueness of each person's gift and talent. There's so much beauty that sometimes we are blind to it because we cannot see it. It's just so small that you need a microscope to really see the divine. Connect with your inner child. Make a paper snowflake or two. And as you're doing it, pray, yes, Lord, I want to live for you. I want to serve you. Here I am. But realize that God too is saying the exact same thing. God wants us to notice God first, to hear God's voice first, to get to the work that we have, but to make sure that that work doesn't crowd out God. It is so good to be here with you. And it is so good to share with you my paper snowflakes. So my friends, listen to God today, tomorrow, in the week to come. Hold off on saying, here I am, Lord. But embrace the silences. Make an empty space. Carve out the time. Slow down. Say no to all the Zoom meetings. I wish I could. And realize that before you say yes to serving God, really listen first to hearing God. Until next week, thanks be to God. Thank you.
follow.